We welcome you to the media ministry of Denton Bible Church. Our speaker today is the senior pastor, Tom Nelson.
A classic statement by a classic man of this period that we'll be studying. His name is Mr. Benjamin Franklin, and on his deathbed, he was visiting with Ezra Stiles, that happened to be the president of Yale University. And Franklin said, as to inquiries about his soul, Franklin said, "As to Jesus of Nazareth, I have some doubts as to his divinity, though it is a question I do not dogmatize upon. Having never studied it, and I think it needless to busy myself with it now, when I expect soon an opportunity of knowing the truth with less trouble." That's what death will do. It'll educate you in theology. "I see no harm, however, in its being believed, if that belief," meaning in his deity, "has the good consequence of making his doctrines more respected and better observed." Now, where did Ben Franklin get this type of flippancy toward the Word of God? "Concerning the divinity of Jesus, I'm not sure, nor do I care." Where did he get this sort of idea of utility? "I think that a belief in Jesus' deity is okay, provided it ensures for a higher degree of morality." Flippancy, utility, the idea of a secular life and a sacred life, beliefs and behavior that do not mix. Where did Franklin get that? Well, Ben Franklin got it because that was his day. He was a child of what is called the Enlightenment. The Enlightenment is what we're going to study this morning. It is that period from the Peace of Westphalia in 1648 and the beginning of religious toleration to the French Revolution in 1789. And let me tell you something about the period of the Age of Reason or the Enlightenment. People ask me sometimes, what can I read to really clue me in on Christianity of today and where we are? And I tell them, if you can study the period of the late 1600s, early 1700s, the phenomena that is called the Enlightenment, and of Christianity's response to it, you can understand where we are today. There are going to be two motions that are going to begin in this period that are still with us today. The idea of a secular life that is separate from a spiritual life, of keeping Christianity sequestered in church and in home, that's my private belief, you believe what you want to. The secular life and sacred life division is going to begin right here at the period called the Enlightenment. The response the church is going to have to it is something that's called pietism, and that's going to become present-day evangelical Christianity. The idea of a confessing church, and within that confessing church, groups and an inner core of people of Bible study, prayer, holiness, witnessing, and missions. That's called evangelical Christianity. Those who feel that they are to bear the good news, the evangel. That church within a church mentality is going to begin in the Enlightenment. It's Christianity's answer to the Enlightenment. And so unless you really understand what's about to happen, this tear in the fabric that is going to sever completely, within 100 years, by the 1900s, it's going to tear completely. And with the arisal of the idea of evolution, and then the arisal of liberal theology that will literally downcast Christianity, with those arisals, you're going to have, in the 20th century, your totally different people in different universes. The secular humanist and the believer, the Christian. That's going to begin right here. Every one of you in this building has been affected by what we're going to study this morning, the Enlightenment. What the Enlightenment is, in simple, it is the exaltation of reason over the Bible. Or to put it clearer, it is the exaltation of man in the place of God. The Reformation answered a challenge of the late Middle Ages of legalism. Were you saved by faith in Jesus Christ, or were you saved by faith plus the works of man? The Reformation took that challenge of the late Middle Ages head on, as we've seen over the last 2 weeks. What we're going to see now from this period on is a different challenge to the very foundations of Christianity. Is the Bible of any credibility whatsoever? Has God spoken at all? Is God really Trinity? Is man naturally sinful? Is Jesus Christ God? Did his death have any efficacy to save man? And does man even need saving? And is there such a thing as hell and such a thing as heaven? Is anything true that can't fit into my reason? Now, that notion begins in the Enlightenment, the exaltation of reason over Bible, man over God. So the church is going to have to answer a whole new challenge. Let me show you what we're going to look at over the next 2 weeks. The Enlightenment is a movement that is going to begin, and the church is going to answer it in the phenomena that is called pietism. I want you to help me out here. I need to know who I'm talking to. How many of you, once again, if I ask you to write down what you knew about the phenomena of pietism, would be in a heap of trouble? Would you raise your hand? If you don't, I'm going to make you lecture. So, all right, good. You don't know? That's great. That's why we're doing this. The Enlightenment will be answered by pietism, and the outworking of pietism is going to be a phenomena that is called the Great Awakening. You're going to see in England and then in America, one out of every 10 human beings in this country is going to be converted. It's going to be what one author said was like the entire world was in a turmoil to know God. It's called the Great Awakening. And the churches are going to grow so huge because these conversions will not just be the going forward or raising a hand. They're going to be people that will profess Christ and join churches. And it's going to be so huge, and the American church is so going to flourish that the idea, are you ready for a word, of voluntarism is going to be a possibility. Let me tell you what that means. From 312 AD on, the state has to support and take care of the church. Could the church take care of itself simply by the love of God and the voluntary gifts of the Christians? That notion was an idea that was called voluntarism, and people wondered if it would ever work. Could you run the church with no state intervention or meddling, just the voluntarism commitment of the people? Well, after the Great Awakening, Jefferson and all of the rest are going to back up and say, I'll be dogged. It works. We do not need to meddle in Christianity. And you're going to see the phenomena that is known as the First Amendment of the separation of church and state. And that phenomena that has been unheard of through all of history that is called the United States of America. Are you with me? Enlightenment, the response of pietism, the outworking of the revival, and the result of what is called by Franklin the New Order of the United States. Let me begin with just telling you what the Enlightenment was. Bruce Shelley had a church history book, and it's one of the best I've ever read. And the chapter on the Enlightenment is called Aiming at the Foundation. And by that I mean that up until this point, you have had within the confessing Christian church different ideas that Christians will challenge Christians. The Enlightenment is going to be a hard left. You're going to see people that are not Christians, they're proud of the fact that they are not Christians. As a matter of fact, they will label themselves, they will call themselves infidels. And they will feel Christianity is one of the great superstitions that has held back the progress of man and caused men to kill each other. And they're going to come after Christianity, not with how the Bible is interpreted within. They're going to come from the outside and they're going to shell it with the idea that the Bible is fanciful, that its beliefs are unreasonable and even immoral. And you're going to have the arisal of the greatest of all people that you have to debate with. Do you know who the hardest guy is in the world to debate with? They. You know what I'm saying? You know what they say? That's the ultimate quietus of an argument. What do they say? It's not true. Then it's not. Well, they are going to come after you. They're going to be called scientists and they're going to be called philosophers. That's the, listen to the quote by Shelley. I can't say any better than this. The Reformation proved again that faith and power are a potent brew. As long as Christianity had power, it would compel men to believe. You see, Europe had seen the compulsion of Catholics and of Protestants. Our state will be this, and if you are not that, we will kill you. And they had seen war, holy war. And as a result, they're going to revolt throughout all of Europe, and that revolt is going to be called the Enlightenment. We're tired of this 30 years of killing of Protestants and Catholics. We're tired of burnings at the stake. We're tired of beheadings. No idiosyncrasy of dogma is worth burning some human being at the stake. And so the parents are going to give a war that nobody's going to show up to. The Peace of Westphalia was the kids of the 30 years war saying, that's all. There's no winners. We're all losers and we're finished with it. And that was the beginning of religious toleration in Europe. Now, the Enlightenment is going to be a brand new way of looking at life. No longer are you going to look at life through Scripture, but you're going to look at life through reason. And it's going to be the exaltation of what we call secularism. And you can probably put a word in right here. What would you call it where you don't interpret life through the Bible and truth, but you interpret it through the senses and the reason of, and I'll give you a little help on this, through the senses and reason of humans. I just helped you. It's called humanism. Where man becomes the arbiter of what is true. Peter Gay, in his book on the Enlightenment, you know what he called the Enlightenment? He said the Enlightenment, colon, the beginnings of paganism. And it is. Late 1600s, early 1700s. Where did it come from? It came from the premise that the sufficient means of knowing truth is man. That prior to the Enlightenment, reason served faith. Reason obeyed faith, whether it was the dictates of the church and Catholicism, or whether it was the presentation of the Bible and Protestantism. Men in the Reformation and before assumed that their reason was not infallible, that their reason was short-sighted, that there were certain things they could not understand as men. And thus their reason worked within the confines of the truth of God. Reason served faith. After this point, no longer will that be. Faith or reason will replace faith. Let me read to you a fellow of this time of what he said. His name is von Halbach, and he wrote, "Let us endeavor to disperse the clouds of ignorance, those mists of darkness which impede man on his journey, which prevent his marching through life with a firm and steady step. Let us try to inspire him with respect for his own reason, with an inextinguishable love of the truth, that he may learn to know himself and no longer to be duped by imagination. The imagination that has been led astray by authority, so that he may learn to base his morals on his own nature, his own wants, to the real advantage of society, that he may learn to pursue his true happiness by promoting the happiness of others. In short, that he may become a virtuous, rational being who cannot fail to be happy." The Enlightenment was called the Enlightenment by men of that time that felt that the worst thing that ever happened to humanity was Christianity and Judaism and religion. They feel that the Renaissance freed man from a lot of that, that the Reformation came back in and recaptured the thoughts of man and abused man by religious leaders and political leaders, and now man was going to tear himself free from this and put down those superstitions and put down those ideas and lift up the nobility of man. No longer will we burn them at the stake and kill them. We will exalt man. And listen to me, when you're in a day that 35% of Europe is dying to war, that's a pretty good-looking thesis. So the Enlightenment was not seen as a darkening or an error. It was seen as the redemption of history by a group of people that were putting down the wicked imaginations of religion. How did it happen? Man began to reject the notion of Christianity after 30 years of religious war. Their thought is, whatever it is that caused men to be so disseminated and destroyed and debauched cannot be true. And you will see the phenomena of what is known as scientia, knowledge, science. Modern science begins. Now, we don't realize how powerful this notion is. This was not a group of men that merely discovered new lands. They discovered laws that caused the universe to run. So no longer did it look like God was a good shepherd. It looked like there were laws that ran what was called the clockwork universe or the world machine. And you didn't need an immanent God. You could have a God that made things and was absentee landlord. This is prior to Darwin, so you couldn't be an atheist. You still had to be a theist. That God had made the universe and had left, and he did not reveal himself. And it was up to man to pull himself up by his own bootstraps. Look at some of these fellows who came around here. First one, Copernicus, set forth the idea that the earth was not the center of the universe, it was the sun. After him was Johann Kepler, that discovered magnetic force, that the sun emitted a magnetism, and that mystified man. There was an answer now. Galileo, the constant speed of acceleration of falling objects, and then the biggie, Sir Isaac Newton, and his idea of this cohesive field of the universe called gravity. One fellow wrote at that time, "Nature and nature's law lay hid in night. God said, let Newton be, and all was light." And so now, as you looked at the universe, you did not have to say that God was there preserving it. You said there was natural law. How do you know? Because they say, the scientists, the smart guys, Galileo, Copernicus, Newton, Kepler, and the like. A change has now come. You ready? The change was no longer that man was a sinful creature, ignorant and fallen, and God, by virtue of the Bible, would give wisdom, and by the chief premise of that Bible, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah of the Old Testament, the Savior of the New, that now man could have grace and forgiveness as dispensed by the church and their evangel. That notion that had been all up until then is now cast down as condescending and bad. Man is not evil. He is good. He does not need grace. He just needs a good education. All man needs is reason. And it's during this time, I thought about not throwing this in here to confuse you, but I want you to understand where it comes from. Modern philosophy begins right here. Descartes in France, that sets aside his Bible, takes human reason, begins with the most primitive truth, I think, therefore I am, I think. Cogito ergo sum. He starts with the most primitive notion, I exist, and I think, therefore I must be. The next assumption was that there must be someone who made him, that there was God. But you begin with rationalistic philosophy. The Bible is put aside, and a rational means is thought of to come to truth. After him come the empiricist, that said you don't need so much reason, you need your senses to discern experience. Your mind is a tabula rasa, a blank slate. It learns by experiences. You're going to see the rationalist, the empiricist, and they just keep these philosophic schools going. So the birth of modern science and the birth of modern philosophy begin in contrast to the Bible, and they're going to get farther and farther away. Man does not need salvation. He's not lost. He's just darkened. He needs reason. Now, I want to show you what happened to Christians. As these ideas are starting to come out, this kind of optimism is starting to rise. Christians do one thing, the pagans do another. You see what is called the reduction of Christianity. Christians began to take notions of the faith that weren't quite reasonable and to discount them. Original sin was put down. The Trinity was put down because it wasn't reasonable. The deity of Christ, salvation by him being punished for another sin, that's not reasonable. We put that down. A lot of these were set forward by this fellow. His name is John Locke. And he reduced Christianity to its most basic, unchallengeable notions that there is a God and Jesus was his Messiah. Now, everything else kind of got put to the side because men weren't sure. And so by the 1700s, Christianity starts to trim its sails. Do y'all know what I mean by that? Just like a captain of a boat will turn his sail to the prevailing wind. The prevailing wind of science and philosophy is that Christianity and its supernatural notions were unreasonable, and they caused warfare, and they were destructive. Instead of Christians standing and offering an apologetic for their faith, what we did is we began tearing out of our Bibles things that they didn't agree with. And you saw now Christianity become a taxidermist model with no guts and viscera to it. Just the idea of God, a historical man, Jesus, and everything after that was up for grabs. As a matter of fact, we had a religion come out of this. We've even got one of the churches here in Denton, Texas. Whenever you took the notion of Christianity and got rid of everything that was unreasonable, the primary issue that was unreasonable was the idea that God was one and three, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And we came up with a religion in Boston that was called Unitarianism. The unity of God is just one without a Trinity. And so the Unitarian Church begins in Boston. It was called the Brotherhood of God, of Man under the Fatherhood of God in the neighborhood of Boston. Unitarianism. And not only did you see the reduction of Christianity, but you began to see through this fellow the outright renunciation of Christianity. I would love to have met this fellow. I'm afraid I won't, but I would love to. He is fascinating reading, and I'll tell you what, I would have hated to have met him head to head because he was acid. Some Christian somewhere hurt this guy. His name is Voltaire. He began what was called the French Enlightenment and a group of men called the Philosophes, the Philosophias, the lovers of wisdom. And they set aside the Bible as primitive. He called Christianity, quote, that infamous thing that promotes such darkness and evil among men. He said, they have preached so long that man is darkened and evil. He wrote 10,000 published letters. He was the rave throughout France. He said that within 100 years after of his life, that Christianity would be extinct. He pushed the greatest, most tumultuous revolution the world's ever seen, and it's never recovered. From the 1780s on, the entirety of feudal Europe, kings, monarchies, Catholicism is coming to the ground by the revolutions of Europe and the exaltation of man. Demokratos. Democracy is going to raise up and man will rule. The Pope is going to be exiled to the Vatican, and his ideas are the most cataclysmic ideas. Voltaire, Charles Darwin, Immanuel Kant are men that just bring these intellectual bombshells to humanity. And he brings one. He made you as a Christian feel that you were not only stupid, but you were immoral, that you had held back the progress of man that could have been so under Aristotle and Plato. In comes the stupidity of Christianity. We tried to rebel against it in the Enlightenment, and instead you got all these monks squabbling in Saxony, he said, and the Reformation, and it was up to man to rid himself of what was called, now listen to what he called Christianity. He called it priestcraft, not witchcraft. But priestcraft. He would say that the basic notion, the most primitive notion, is there was a creator that created with order, and there was moral order called love and civility. What men had done is, in the longing for power and wealth, they had invented religion. And you had the imposition of priestcraft, whether it be Islam, Judaism, or the infamous and most perverse of all that was called Christianity. There's a great set of volumes by a fellow named Will Durant. You got him? History of Civilization? Don't read him either. I don't either, but it looks great on your shelf. It's about this big by Will Durant, who was an atheist. And he said of Christianity and Judaism, there was no more odious deity than Jehovah. And this fellow could make you feel stupid. He began the first pagan religion. It was called deism. You ever heard of deism? Deoism. He reduced religion to the most rational, simple of ideas. There is a creator, and that man should love. Everything else that has bifurcated and invented their own religion is priestcraft. Do you know what they did in the French Revolution? They took a statue of Mary and pulled it down. They took a French prostitute and exalted her as reason. No longer God, but reason was exalted. They even got rid of, in France, the seven-day week. The seven-day week is an imposition of God, they felt, on by the notion of Christianity and Judaism, that there is a creator. They had a 10-day week to get rid of the Sabbath. They even got rid of the calendar. They said, our calendar dates Anno Domini, and they call Jesus Lord. We are rid of that notion. They threw away the calendar. They made the year 1, 1789, in the French Revolution. Now, that's what you call rebellion. The kids of the 60s were just pikers compared to these guys. And they made government not the rule of God. They made it Rousseau's social contract, that we all agree democratically and we put who we want. And incidentally, if you disagreed with those fellas, they would cut your head off. Where you don't have the rule of absolute truth outside of man, you're going to have a group of men, and whoever disagrees with them, you're going to have to kill them. See also Russia, Nazi Germany, and revolutionary France. Didn't work. It became the rage, deism did. At Harvard, young men would nickname themselves Voltaire and Rousseau. And it began to be seen that Christianity was an ancient, devolution of right religion. We needed to take those inherent things to Christianity, God and the love of man, get rid of them, and hold to the basic ideas of deism. All right? Well, it didn't work, incidentally, because deism's too cold. Whenever I meet a deist today, I see him and I say, "Whoa, welcome to Jurassic Park," because he's a dinosaur. Deism passed away because it's too cold. In deism, he's the absentee landlord. There's a God who doesn't care about you. He doesn't love you. And so if you know your history, you begin to see after deism, the exaltation of nature with a capital N. Nature became God. Wordsworth, Gerald Manley Hopkins, remember him? Henry David Thoreau. They're called transcendentalists. That there was a transcendent nature of a God. And it was kind of a weak deal. Are you with me? The result of deism is that you now had secular and sacred. You had the idea that you could be a Christian, and you kept your Christian ideas in the home and in the church, in polity, in politics, and in civil life. It was exempted. And also you had the notion that Christianity was a bad imposition on humanity by the priests. And there's another factor that hit at this time. All the state churches of Europe, the Lutherans of areas of Germany, the Lutherans of the Netherlands, the Reformed ideas of Holland, the Anglicans of England, the Presbyterians of Scotland, they had their state churches and their state confessional creeds. When a kid was born, if you were going to live there, that kid was going to be baptized into that church. And now, after a couple of generations, by the 1700s, you had Europe full of non-Christian, unconverted Protestants, like a lot of you were. Amen? A lot of you were. You were baptized as Lutherans. You were baptized as Catholics. You were baptized as in the Reformed faith. You were baptized whatever, but you weren't converted. Well, now throughout all of Europe, you had the state church with unconverted people. So folks, by the time you get to about the early 1700s, Christianity in Europe is in a bad shape. Scientifically and intellectually, it looks out of step, in need of reform, that we need to get rid of the Bible. It even looks to where it's historically, morally, a bad thing for man. They are now no longer a group of priests that disagree with Protestants. They're scientists. They're philosophers. They're the famous. They are Voltaire, Diderot, Denis. They're these Frenchmen that challenge your faith. So, and throughout all of Europe, you turn to the church, and you don't have this vital, vibrant group of people like the Puritans had been. You have dead Lutherans, dead Presbyterians, dead Anglicans. You don't have dead Baptists, because they really are dead. Somebody killed them, probably. They're just on the run, Baptists trying to survive. Well, what happened was a response. Pietism. Y'all know what pietism is? It's a marvelous thing that happened in the 1700s. Let me tell you about this. Pietism, the word piety means inner obedience. Piety means duty. And there was a revival throughout the European church where people began to long for an inner, deep, spiritual obedience to God. That's pietism. It stressed three things. Now tell me if these look familiar to you, because pietism is going to start a movement, a sacred movement in light of the secular, and that rift is never going to be healed. This Enlightenment movement is going to get wider and wider and wider, and it's going to get supported by liberalism that'll challenge the very literary nature of the Bible. It's going to be challenged by evolution, and this rift at the Enlightenment is going to get huge. It's going to get so great that in 20th century America, a kid can take an assault rifle and go kill everybody in a school and feel no conscience about it. That's how broad it's going to get. The reaction is going to be the idea that within the visible, organized church, there's an inner core of the holy. Now, that's called evangelicalism, the church within the church of the Bible students, the prayers, the committed, those who share their lives, who witness and do missions. That notion of the church within began with pietism. They held, can you believe this? That you had to have a personal conversion. They held that it wasn't enough that you could just simply be a Presbyterian or an Anglican or a Lutheran. You had to be able to give for an encounter you had with God. They called it enthusiasm, entheos, enthusiasm in God. They called it experimental religion. You had to meet God and be converted. One of the great preachers of this was Mr. George Whitfield of England, one of the great English pietists. And he used to preach, ye must be born again. And a lady said to him, why do you keep saying you must be born again? He said, because you must be born again. You had to have a personal conversion. They also believed that within the established, visible Lutheran, Presbyterian church, Reformed church, that there was an inner core of those who studied their Bible, prayed, loved each other, and shared their faith. The church within a church. Let me show you how personal this is. Denton Bible is a pietistic church. Do you know that? You didn't know what kind of church you were in. We are an extension of pietism. Meaning that we have about 3,000 people that come to this church. There is an outer edge of this church that are nominal, gnome, name. They are nominal Christians. They're what's called Lady Clairols that only God knows for sure. All right. Now, none of them come to the second service, so you don't have to worry about it. They go to those other services. And they are nominal. Their giving is when it's convenient. They pray when they're in trouble. They don't know their Bibles, nor do they care, but they know they're supposed to be here. Generally, it's a guy being drugged here by his wife, or a kid by his parents, or something. But we have a great outer rim of nominal Christians. I'm sorry, but we do. I'd rather have them here than anyplace else. But on the inside, you have the furnace of this church. And it's a group of people that read their Bibles daily, that pray without ceasing, that share their faith diligently and are willing to suffer and hold to the great doctrines of the faith. They are those that struggle with holiness. They are those that have an accountability and they challenge each other. They long to see people come to Christ and to invest their lives for eternity. Well, that notion of a pious group within a professing and confessing church starts in the period of the Enlightenment. It's a response to the Enlightenment. And this church, these groups would hold to spiritual disciplines. They actually felt that everybody could read their Bible. They felt that everybody could share their faith. And you know what they began doing at this time? They began making people mad. Because these pietistic Germans would actually challenge other Lutherans that they weren't converted because they were in that Lutheran church. They would challenge Anglicans that they weren't converted because they were good English baptized men. And it caused trouble. If you want to get a good picture of this, there was a pietistic movement 30 years ago within the Confessing Methodist Church. And I watched it happen because I was a Methodist assistant pastor in the early 70s. How many of you remember in Methodism what was called the lay witness missions? Any of you remember those? They were wonderful. They would bring in great groups of Methodist laymen and women, and they would get up in the pulpit and share on how they had met Jesus Christ and been converted. This thing came to the church that I was at in the early 70s, and it totally overturned the church. We had the most pious, godly woman in our church got up and got saved. It shook us up. That woman did not know Christ. She came forward. The place went dead silent. And Miss Lucille Granny Peel got converted by the Holy Ghost. And everybody got shook up. And a bunch of people got mad. You're actually saying that you could be a Methodist and unconverted. Well, it happened here in Pietism. Are you with me? Let me tell you something, how it got started. Don't worry about these names. Frankfurt, Germany, a fellow named Philip Spener began to preach and call men to holiness. He put aside his notes and he began to speak out about immorality, shallow belief, and you must be born again. He saw people in his Lutheran church become converted, and they began meeting twice weekly in homes for Bible study, prayer, fellowship, and accountability. Unheard of. Frankfurt, Germany. Late 16, early 1700s. Then a professor at Halle, Germany, named August Frank, takes a group of students and begins to get them together in small groups to do Bible study, prayer, scripture memory, fellowship, holding each other accountable, and they began to do what we just announced this morning about 45 minutes ago. You remember at the beginning of this service, I said, if you have carpentry skills, we've got a woman out here in Aubrey that's in need and she's in trouble. Come help us. We of the church are going to go minister. This guy started doing that. He began a house for widows. He began an orphanage. He began a Latin school for the brilliant kids of the schools. He began an outreach to India. August Frank at Halle, Germany, among students. And it spread. Then this guy got it big. He is in Moravia of what is now Germany at a city called Herrnhut. The persecuted Bohemians came to this man for safety. The Unitas Fratrum, the United Brotherhood of Bohemia that held to John Huss's doctrine that were persecuted by the Catholic Church, came to him. He put them up in his house. That's when you know you're rich. When you can take a persecuted denomination and house them in your home. And he put them on his home. And they were called, how many of you have ever heard of the Moravian Brethren? Well, it started with this fellow. And his house became almost like a commune. And people started coming all over Germany to see people that studied their Bible, prayed, held each other accountable, and they began the first modern missions movement in the late 1600s. Count von Zinzendorf, they went to the West Indies. Moravians became impassioned missionaries. They did missionary work to Georgia in the United States. Did you know that? America was a mission field. And a group of Moravians came over here to preach the gospel. There was a young Anglican on the boat named John Wesley. And a Moravian named Peter Bohler challenged him that he was not good enough for heaven and ultimately brought him to the saving knowledge of Christ. This fellow right here within Catholicism, Blaise Pascal, he was a genius, invented a adding machine as a teenager for his father to help him in his business. That's when you're smart. Was a mathematician. He was the fellow who made the statement, you've heard me say it before, there's a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of every man that he tries to fill with the created, but it can only be filled by the Creator. This man said it, was a prolific author throughout Catholicism, called Catholicism back to that Christianity was more than just being baptized into a religion. It was a relationship with God. Blaise Pascal. Well, let me just real quickly. This church within idea, here's what we owe them. See if this looks familiar. We owe them the idea of emotion. Before then, it was considered rude to be emotional. They actually held that you could love God emotionally. They held to a church within a church that was the furnace of the church. They held to preaching that you could actually raise your voice and get all excited. Those were the Pietists. They wrote hymns. One of the great pietists was Charles Wesley, that wrote 7,000 Christian hymns. The missions movement we owe to the pietist. And this event, they're going to see a fellow within the pietist come to faith. He's going to start something in England that, by the grace of God, that was begun in America, that is called the Great Awakening. And this fellow that they saw come to faith, these Moravian pietists, becomes the greatest organizer in the history of the faith. He begins what became in America the largest denomination in our country by the 1850s. Who do you think I'm talking about? You ever heard of this fellow? Just listen to this, at what God did in 1700 with this guy. He is a pietist. Son of an Anglican minister named Samuel, born in 1710, one of 19 kids. Had a mother named Susanna. You know what he said his child rearing consisted of? She told him, "Fear the rod and cry softly." How's that for child rearing? His father was an Anglican minister, and the church at Epworth, England, happened not to like his preaching, and so they burned down his house. Don't even think about it. But they burned his house down. This little fellow, young Charles or John, he got caught in the fire. And they made a human chain of men that went up and pulled him out. And his mother told him from the time he was a little boy that he was special. She said, "You're a brand plucked from the burning." Because he literally was yanked out of a fire. He goes to Oxford University, which is deistic by this time. He is an intellectual Christian. He has never been converted. He is simply a good confessing Anglican studying for the ministry. He reads a book by a fellow named Thomas A Kempis on the imitation of Christ, and he saw that the Christian life is a total consecration of the whole man to Jesus, and he tried to do it in and of himself, began a group at Oxford called the Holy Club. He and a young guy named George Whitfield began meeting together for prayer, Bible study, worship, and singing. They were scorned by all of the fellows at Oxford. He leaves from Oxford to come to Georgia in the United States to do mission work, and he got into a scandal with a young girl he was teaching French to, was run out of Georgia. It was scandalous. He came back to the United States. He said, "I came to convert the heathen, but who will convert me?" On the boat ride, he got into a great storm at sea, and there were a group of Moravians on the ship. And he feared for his life, and he watched these Moravians. And you know what they were doing during the storm? They were praying and singing. And he simply said, "These folks have something I have never, ever seen. They actually know God." Came back to London defeated. Was invited by these Moravians to come to a place in London called Aldersgate Street. And there he came. Now, this is the reason why you see about every third Methodist church named Aldersgate. There at Aldersgate, the Moravians read. They had what was called public readings. And they read Martin Luther's preface to the Book of Romans, where Martin Luther talked about his striving to earn the salvation of God, found out that it came through Jesus Christ alone, and was converted and entered into the great gates of heaven with great joy. And Wesley heard that and said, as these going along talking about Luther striving to earn the righteousness of God, he said, "That's me." Of Luther's efforts, "That's me." The recognition of his sin, Wesley said, "That's me." And then all of a sudden, Luther said he was converted by faith alone in Jesus Christ, and it clicked to young John. He'd memorized scads of verses, he just didn't know what they meant. And all of a sudden it clicked. And he said in his own words, and I quote, "My heart was strangely warmed." And he was converted. Began to preach, saw no great results until one of his buddies in the Holy Club named George Whitfield was a little bit more radical than him. Whitfield was a pietist that began doing something very strange. He began preaching outdoors to miners, preaching outdoors to farmers. He got so famous that the Anglican church wouldn't let him in because he practiced what was called enthusiasm. He preached with emotion. He asked young John, come to Bristol, England, and I want you to preach to minors. And young John said he was a proper Englishman, didn't know if he could do it because you had to preach outdoors and that meant you had to raise your voice. He said, I don't know. He said, I'll do it. Had 3,000 people. How would you like to talk to 3,000 people outdoors without a mic? He prayed, he lifted up his soul, and he heralded extemporaneous the cross. And then he did something that no man ever did. He gave you a chance to repent, to right there, to believe. If you're in a bus, it'll wait. If you're here with a friend, he'll wait. Actually, Billy said that, John didn't. But it was a lot like that. Believe now the gospel. And he called you emotionally to believe. And do you know what? He was like a kid with a new toy. The Spirit of God went out and touched people and they became converted. And he realized that the greatest thing in the world was his conversion. And the next greatest thing was he actually could go to lost men and call them to believe. And this fellow began, though he didn't intend it, he began his own denomination. He didn't die a Methodist. He died an Anglican. He started going all over England, Wales, Ireland, Scotland, preaching outdoors. He was so famous that still today you can get little China statues of Wesley from the 1700s. They're greatly revered. He was one of the most loved men in all England, but the Anglicans wouldn't let him in their churches because he practiced enthusiasm and he insulted people by calling them lost. He saw so many people come to faith that he began his own group. He would organize you into societies, and he would divide you into 12-man classes that had one leader on them, and they would begin you with basic Bible doctrine, and then they would begin you in basic spiritual disciplines of Bible study and prayer. He said, give me 12 men who fear nothing but God and sin, and I will shake the world. And he began societies. Tell me what you think they were called. They were people, give you a hint, who had their own method of spiritual growth by disciplines, and they were called by their enemies Methodists. The Methodist societies grew. He began to have church annual meetings with them. And listen, by the time this guy dies, at the age of 81 in 1791, and he died an Anglican, he would not divide within the dead Anglican church these Methodists. He made them stay Methodists. Except in the United States, after the Revolutionary War, it was more advantageous for them to break from obviously an adversarial position as Anglicans, and they became Methodist in 1784 in the United States. Philadelphia. Or was it Baltimore? I forget. Anyway, here's what this guy did in his lifetime. Each year of his life, as a Christian, he traveled 4,500 miles on horseback to preach. He would preach 3 to 4 times a day. He trained his horse that the horse could walk by itself. He would prop his feet up on the saddle, guide by his feet the reins, and hold the horse in check while he would read Christian literature. 4,500 miles a year he travels. It is estimated that by the time he dies, he has traveled 250,000 miles on horseback to preach. Our world is 25,000 miles in circumference. He circled the world 10 times on foot to preach. Son. He was an Arminian. He did not hold to the predestination of God and the sovereignty of God and salvation. He broke from Whitfield in that. He felt that God, he coined a term, prevenient grace, freed the souls of darkened men to be able to freely believe. He felt that salvation, he was an Arminian idea of man cooperating by a free will with God to believe. He also began something that is with us until today. He felt that after conversion, you had to have a second blessing. And this activity of God that was later called the baptism of the Holy Ghost enables you to Christian perfection. The holiness movement that would become the Pentecostal movement, that would become the charismatic movement, are the children of John Wesley. He's a good lesson. He was the greatest organizer that has ever lived in Christianity. But you need to be careful on your theology. Theology always goes in like a bullet, but it comes out this big. I think that he made a theological error in some of his stuff. And it opened up today in a huge, I think, erroneous movement. We never need to exceed what is written. He dies at the age of 81 with 79,000 Methodists in England, 40,000 Methodists in the United States. And his best friend, until they broke over Calvinism, Mr. John or George Whitfield, is going to come to the United States 7 times and what has been called the greatest revival in the history of man. And we're going to look at that next week. Father in heaven, make us wise in this world that we live in, that is now very firmly defined in lines and different universe that it perceives, the humanist and the believer, the secularist and the sacred. Those that see truth as a variant thing depending upon the ideas of man, and those who see it as revealed to fallible wisdom and reason infallibly in the Word of God. Those notions are still with us today. I pray that you would give us wisdom in our ecclesiology, that there must be today, as then, as indeed within the times of Paul and our Lord, a furnace within the nominal church. I pray that our outer edge would be thin indeed, O God, and this body might be comprised of pietistic, evangelistic, knowledgeable, dogmatic saints of God, a voice of truth and of holiness to a fallen, a materialistic, a humanistic, and indeed a condemned and damned generation of our day. And we'll ask it through Christ our Lord. Amen.